First of all, welcome. So this is our first webinar past the introduction of the We Are Undefeatable in Hertfordshire online conference. We're really happy to have Neil Gibson with us today, who's the Senior Physical Activity Advisor for Diabetes UK, who's going to help us learn a bit more about the importance of being physically active for people that are living with diabetes. Before I hand over to Neil, just some quick webinar housekeeping. So we suggest using the speaker view for your best viewing experience. You can do that at the top right of your screen by clicking the view button. There's a little picture of it on the screen there for you. All participants will still remain muted and cameras off throughout the webinar. However, we do encourage you to continue to comment and network through the chat function. So if you've got any specific offers or you've got an interesting role that you want to introduce to the rest of the group, please do pop it in there. But before you send, make sure you select the everyone option. Otherwise it just comes to us as presenters and we want everyone to learn about everything that's going on. If you have any questions for Neil or any of the HSP team, then please do put them in the Q&A function. We'll attempt to answer all of those within the webinar, but if we run out of time, we will try and respond to those after the event. And the webinar will be recorded and distributed to those that are registered for the event today and also hosted on the website for We Are Undefeatable in Hertfordshire, which is on the screen there. It's sportinhearts.org.uk/LTHC. Finally, if you do, or when you do leave our event today, please do fill in the pop-up feedback survey. It's really important for us to learn what you think of the events as well as what you think should be involved in our local movement going forward. And there's lots of opportunities to do that within there. And if you are coming and going throughout the day, please do feel free to fill that in multiple times based on the webinar that you've just watched. So without any further ado, I think that's everything from me. You're not here to listen to me. You're here to listen to Neil. So I'm going to stop my sharing. And Neil, I invite you to share your screen and introduce yourself.
Perfect. Thanks, Will. Hopefully you can see my screen. See if you can pass the first challenge.
Yeah, that's perfect. Just needs to go full screen. Perfect.
Great. Yes, yeah, so it might be a slight delay. So thanks for the invite. I know we've got quite a mixture of people on the call. So my thinking today was to try and get through some of the basics around diabetes. My background is sports coaching, a personal trainer, PE teacher. So what I was trying to think of, especially from a kind of active partnerships point of view, is what are the key things that I think people will need to know? So the idea from today's session is not to, or for you to go away and become healthcare professionals or experts in diabetes, but just to hopefully a bit more confident in the fact that you know that you, if somebody comes to your session with diabetes, it's not a big panic, you're not worried, but actually you're more confident. And hopefully after this kind of, well, just less than an hour, you realize that it shouldn't be too much of a big deal if somebody with diabetes comes to your session, but there's just ways that we can make the environment a lot better for people and you can be a lot more confident in delivering those sessions. So how I'm going to try and break down the hour is just quickly talk about diabetes in general. People will be at different levels in what they know, but one of the biggest things we hear from people with diabetes that go to gyms and sports venues is some of the generalizations that are made about diabetes that are often, you know, really inaccurate. So hopefully I'll try and get around some of that. I'll obviously talk about diabetes and physical activity and the links and the main things you need to know. Hopefully the tips for coaches and clubs and anybody that works in the physical activity industry will be really helpful for you. And then we should hopefully have a little bit of time for Q&A at the end. But as Will said, feel free to ask questions throughout. And hopefully everyone can hear me okay. I'm speaking fairly quickly because there's a lot to get through. So some of the slides are fairly wordy, just because you can look at this in your own time. So diabetes is a very complex issue. I've just tried to break it down as simple as I can. So this is the most complex, and I suppose I'm going to make it in terms of what is diabetes. So it's a serious condition where blood glucose, which is also known as blood sugar, is too high. So basically there's too much sugar in your blood. So blood glucose, blood sugar. The way you get that glucose and that blood sugar and that sugar into your blood is by the food you eat. So primarily carbohydrate. So when somebody with diabetes is looking at a packet of food, they will be looking at the full carbohydrate content. So not just the of which sugars bit, they need to look at the full carbohydrate. So basically you want the, when you eat, so somebody without diabetes, when they eat, the sugar or the glucose that's in their blood will go into their cells. That's because they have insulin that will work effectively and properly to get that into the cells. If you have diabetes, however, your insulin, you either don't produce enough of it or it doesn't work properly. So that means that the blood doesn't get into the cells, it stays, the sugar doesn't get into the cells, it stays in your blood. And we know that if blood stays in your, if sugar stays in your blood, then you'll have high blood glucose levels and your blood can become acidic. So that can lead to very serious health problems. So things like amputations, kidney damage, nerve damage, and so on. So that's as simple as I can make it. It is a very complex condition. No two people are the same. So there's lots of different things going on as well. So there's two main types of diabetes that I'm sure you've all heard of, type 1 and type 2. So when you have type 1 diabetes, you can't make any insulin at all. If you have type 2, the insulin you make either isn't enough or it doesn't work effectively. So they're both different conditions, but they're both very serious. And then there's some other types of diabetes as well that you may hear, but these are much rarer. So there's gestational diabetes, which some women may develop during pregnancy. You have type 3C, there's cystic fibrosis diabetes, LADA, MODY, lots of different ones. But the main two that for people that you will work with will be type 1 and type 2. With type 1 diabetes, there's only one treatment for that. So that's to replace insulin. So people with type 1 diabetes aren't producing any insulin, so they have to have an insulin pump or insulin injections. So forget what you hear sometimes on the celebrity pages or the tabloids, where someone might have a new diet that has helped cure type 1 so that you don't need to take insulin, or someone on a new fitness regime where they don't need to take insulin. If you have type 1 diabetes, you have to take insulin. So because of that, people with type 1 diabetes will need to test their blood sugars regularly. So there's different ways that they can do that. So they need to know what their blood sugar levels are, so then they know how much insulin they need. One of the things you will find with that, and one of the problems, is the fact that it's hard to measure or keep your blood sugar levels at a healthy level. So you can either go too high, which is called hyper or hyperglycemia, or you can go too low, which is called hypo or hyperglycemia. So that's because it's very hard to balance the amount of carbohydrate you're eating with the amount of insulin you're taking. But also anything that happens in the past 24 hours can also affect your blood sugar levels. So that might be exercise. It might be if you're feeling unwell. It could be stress, alcohol. There's lots of different things. With type 2 diabetes, so this will be the majority of people that you work with, because type 2 diabetes is much more common than type 1. Here's where it gets even more tricky, because of the fact that each individual is different with their treatment options. So some people won't need to take insulin with type 2 diabetes, whereas some will. Some people may have to take other medication that can lower blood sugar levels, and some people may take medication that doesn't lower blood sugar levels. And you'll also find that some people can manage their diabetes with just lifestyle changes. So changes in their diet and exercise, for example. So what you'll find is people coming to your sessions, it might be just, or it will be worth asking and finding out which type of diabetes they have. And if they're type 2, if they're a person with type 2 diabetes, finding out what medication they use. So you know that, are they on something like insulin that can lower blood sugar levels and change your blood sugar levels, or are they managing it through lifestyle changes? So if you are taking insulin or anything that can change your blood sugar levels, you will need to be testing your blood sugars regularly so you know what level they're at. So there's a few different ways of testing your blood sugar levels and glucose. So these are the most common, where you can see here, there's a pen that will have a little finger pricker here, a little needle. You'll prick your finger to draw some blood and you put it on some of these test strips. The test strips go into the machine and it will tell you what your number is. Or you can use the more modern way. There's a little disc here and you can hold up a device or a mobile phone and it will tell you what your blood sugar level is at that time. So there's different variations of this. So this is the ways of testing glucose. Once you know what your blood sugar levels are, you'll want to know how much insulin you need to take. So again, this can be done by using a pen. So there's a needle here where you can inject. You have one that are designed for people with dexterity issues, where it's easier to do in bigger numbers of units. And then you also have different types of pumps. So some of the pumps will look like this, where it will give, where you can automatically put insulin into the body. Or it may look a bit more like some of these on their arm, but a bit bigger. So it's different for what different people will use. So what are the common symptoms of diabetes? There's quite a few, but these are some of the main ones. So if somebody's going to the toilet a lot, so that means weeing, especially at night. So if you or you know somebody, your partner is getting up 4 or 5 times per night to go to the toilet for a wee, it might be diabetes. So it's worth getting checked out. If you're really thirsty, if you feel more tired than usual, and if you lose weight without trying to, and there's a few other things as well. But if you spot one or more of these in yourself or somebody, it's worth checking to see if they have diabetes or not. So these are the usual, the main initial symptoms that we see in people. So we call these the 4 T's. So if somebody's getting tired more often, they go in the toilet more, they're more thirsty, and they're becoming thinner without knowing why, then they're the 4 T's of symptoms of diabetes. So if this happens very quick and very sudden, we'd presume that would be type 1 diabetes. However, if this is happening over a longer period of time and you start to see a gradual increase, then we presume that would be type 2 diabetes. So you'd have to go to the hospital to find out for sure. But if you see these symptoms, it's important that you are advising people to get checked out. So this is basically because, as we said before, there's too much blood, there's too much sugar in your blood. So it's making your body work a lot harder. So because that sugar can't get into your cells, it means that your body has to find other ways to get rid of it. So it's getting rid of the sugar by going to the toilet a lot. Because it's having to work so hard, the body is becoming dehydrated. So that's why you become really thirsty and you start to become more tired than usual because there's too much sugar in the blood. So this is very quickly me going through a kind of one-on-one of diabetes and talking very fast. Please ask questions if anything really stands out of not being sure, but I just wanted you to get some of the basics of diabetes first before we talk about the physical activity side. So in terms of the numbers, it's around 90% of people with diabetes have type 2. So that's why I said before, it's more likely that when somebody comes to your session, they will have type 2. And then it's worth finding out what medication and what treatments they use because everybody is different. Here's some of the numbers as well. I won't go into them, but this is just to show that it's very high at the moment in the UK and it's only increasing. So if you're not working with somebody with diabetes at the moment, you probably will at some point in the future. So it's worth having a rough idea of diabetes. I suppose the positive in that is the fact that we know for people, it's not necessarily a death sentence, but if you can do some lifestyle interventions, so the main ones being a change in your diet, so a healthy diet, doing more physical activity and having sustained weight loss can reduce your risk of type 2 by about 50%. So that's the kind of positive of why we want people to be, or one of the reasons you'd want people to be exercising and living that healthy lifestyle. But it's just worth mentioning as well, because of the stigma side, that's still half the people, 50%. So not everybody, just by doing physical activity, losing weight and so on, is necessarily going to go into diabetes remission. And if you have type 1, the problem is that's not going to work at all. So at the moment, there is no cure for type 1. So it doesn't matter how much exercise you do, how great your diet is, etc., how much weight you may lose, or if you're a healthy weight, if you have type 1, unfortunately, it's at the moment it's going to be with you for the rest of your life. However, exercise is still really useful for people with type 1 because of all the other benefits that it brings. I'll just quickly mention two terms that you probably hear of quite a lot. So just to explain what they are. So you may hear people talk about pre-diabetes. So if somebody says, the doctor said I'm pre-diabetic, but that isn't a condition as such. So pre-diabetes basically means you're at risk of developing type 2 diabetes. So it's when your blood sugar level is higher than normal, than a healthy range, but it's not high enough to be classed as having type 2 diabetes. It's basically a way of a doctor saying, look at your lifestyle, look at what you're doing. Your blood sugars are high, so just be careful and think about what to do. So that's where you may see people come to your sessions and say, I have pre-diabetes. What does it mean? Or what should I do? I'm really worried. And the other term you may hear a lot, as I've just mentioned, is diabetes remission. So that's when some people with type 2 were able to put their diabetes into remission, which means that your blood sugar levels are healthy without taking any medication. So somebody's gone back into those healthy levels. As you can see, that's just for people with type 2. So people with type 1 diabetes can't go into remission, and we call it remission rather than reverse, because it can, you can fall back into that level of having diabetes again, of your blood sugars going high. So you need to keep that healthy lifestyle that's helped put you into remission. You need to keep up and keep that sustainable, or else your diabetes, you can become a person with type 2 diabetes again. So hopefully that makes sense. So that's as much as I'm going to cover for a basics of diabetes. Hopefully it makes rough sense how it relates to exercise. So the first thing I should say is that it benefits this exercise benefits people with diabetes the same as those that don't have diabetes. So you don't need to get too bogged down of what the individual benefits are and so on. You all, most of you will be exercise professionals, I'm sure, on the call and know about these things. So I won't go into much depth of what the benefits are, but somebody coming with diabetes to your session should be the same as everybody else in terms of all the extra benefits that it brings of being healthy. However, in terms of diabetes, to be a bit more specific, it does help the body use insulin better. So you become more insulin sensitive. So the less insulin people take, the better. And you know, insulin's a growth hormone. It also helps improve your blood pressure. So that's particularly important for people with diabetes, because we know high blood pressure means you're at more risk of diabetes complications. So some of the things I mentioned before, nerve damage, retinopathy, so eye damage, amputations, that sort of thing. And for people with type 2 diabetes, we know that being active helps improve their HbA1c, so that can help people go into remission. So again, it's not for people with type 1 diabetes, it's people with type 2 where it can help. So HbA1c is basically how much sugar you have in your blood over a 3-month period. So the things I showed you before, when you're pricking your fingers to check your blood sugar levels, that's telling you what your level is there and then. If you went to the hospital for HbA1c test, that is testing it over how much sugar you have in your blood over the 3-month period. It gives an average. It can give a better idea if you have diabetes or not. So again, and this is where in the type 1 community, it can be very annoying when they go to a gym or to an exercise class and are told, you know, if you work really hard in this class and manage to lose weight and so on, your diabetes will go into remission. But for people with type 1 diabetes, that isn't the case. And it's not presumed, it's not for everybody with type 2 either, that you will automatically go into diabetes remission by either losing weight or being really physically active and having a healthier diet. But we know it is the major modifiable risk factor. So it is really helpful and really useful for people to be more active. And with that as well, because we know here all the other benefits that are involved, that's why you wouldn't want to just focus on weight loss, or remission. You want to encourage people because of all the other benefits that people will have. So coming on to, I suppose, specifically around physical activity, one of the key things for people with diabetes is looking after your feet. So why is that so important for someone with diabetes? Those of you that were paying attention before on the slide that I showed with the 4 T's, so the, you know, what are the symptoms of having diabetes? One of those symptoms was the fact that cuts and wounds take longer to heal. So what happens in physical activity, if somebody with diabetes says to you that they've got a sore foot, or you know, they're not, you know, it feels a bit sore, don't just, you know, laugh that off as, you know, oh come on, we're only doing a little walk, or oh, you'll be fine. Because cuts and wounds take longer to heal if you have diabetes, that's when it can lead to much more serious problems. So things like infections, in the worst case scenario, amputations. So a simple cut or a bruise or so on can easily lead to something much more serious if you have diabetes. So that's why it's important that people with diabetes look after their feet. So as I said, if you're leading a session or you see somebody with some sort of foot damage where it could just be small, you know, somebody's limping or somebody tells you that they've got a sore foot, make sure that they're checking and having a look at it. Might mean that they need to actually sit out the session and check their feet. So this is what this picture here represents, is a case of checking your feet. People with diabetes should be checking their feet every day. So ideally before and after sessions. So when people are getting changed and they're putting on their or taking off their socks, make sure that they're looking at their feet. So especially if they've just complained to you that they've got a sore foot, or you know, a dumbbell's landed on their foot or whatever it might be. It's not a case like you might with other people where you could just say, you know, or someone stood on your toe in football, oh, that's not a big deal, come on, carry on, I'm sure it'll be fine. If you have diabetes, you'd want people to be checking their feet at the end for any sort of cuts, bruises and so on. You'd also want to be recommending people to wash their feet daily, to moisturise. A big one for you in the physical activity world is making sure they have the correct footwear on. So that's the suitable footwear for what they're doing, for the sport and activity they're doing, but also making sure that it fits properly. So you're not getting rubbing, you're not getting blisters and so on. And also you want people to have their nails trimmed properly so that they're not cutting into the other toes. So I suppose from your point of view as physical activity professionals, the main ones here would be to make sure people are looking and checking their feet, especially if they just complain that they've got some sort of injury, and to have a look and just make sure they do have the correct footwear for what they're doing, because it is important that people don't damage the feet. The other biggest barrier, so here's always a tricky one, because this won't affect everybody, because as I've said, some type people with type 2 diabetes won't be taking any medication that changes their blood sugar levels. So this isn't a worry for them or a biggest barrier to participating in exercise for them. But for people who do take insulin, so all your type 1s and quite a few of your type 2s, hyperglycemia is the biggest problem. So hyperglycemia or a hypo is when your blood sugars are too low. So it's when they're below 4. So when somebody does their reading on their monitor, if it's below 4, you have to fix that. So you have to have some fast-acting sugar. So that is what is a hypo. We know that exercise can cause hypos in general. If you're doing aerobic activity, your blood sugar levels are going to lower. So that's going to be a barrier and then put people off. But there's ways around that. So the basic main causes of a hypo would be if you've not had enough carbohydrate, so you've not eaten, you've missed your snack, you've had too much insulin, you're doing far too much exercise while having too much insulin in your body, because obviously insulin lowers blood sugar levels, carbohydrate raises them. So not having enough carbs, having too much insulin, doing lots of exercise can all lower your blood sugar levels, as can drinking alcohol, especially on an empty stomach. So I put that one on because that can sometimes confuse people, because alcohol contains sugars. The presumption is that your blood sugar levels are going up, but actually alcohol overrides that and will actually lower. So that's quite an important one, because we know that people will often do sports, adults will do sports, and then straight after go down to the pub. So if you have that empty stomach and diabetes and you're drinking alcohol, make sure that those people are testing their blood sugar levels so that we can make sure that they're above 4, so they're not having a hypo. So what are the symptoms of a hypo? So here's where it's important for you as a sports coach or whatever you do in the physical activity world to recognise these. It can be difficult because some of these are similar to people without diabetes when they're exercising hard, you know, such as sweating. But if you see, you know, a couple of these, here's where somebody might be having a hypo. So what you need to do is just ask them to just sit out and check their blood sugars. If they're a certain number, so if the number's above 4, or quite high, then they can carry on. If it's below that, they have to have some hypo treatment, which I'll come on to what that is in a minute. So some fast acting sugars. So although it sounds really scary, somebody having a hypo, and it is to that person, for you as the coach, it's as simple as if you spot any of these, ask somebody to just sit out for a second and check their blood sugars, so that if they are having a hypo, they can have some fast acting sugars to combat that. One of the other issues as well is the fact that people can become drowsy and confused as a symptom of having a hypo, which can often be misconstrued as being drunk. So if you see adults out and you know somebody has, especially if you know they've had diabetes, if they seem a bit drowsy and confused, often that's passed out as they've had too many beers, and it could be actually that they're having a hypo. So the simplest thing to always do in these situations for anyone with diabetes who takes medications that can lower blood glucose level is just make sure that they're regularly testing their blood sugars. And the person with diabetes should know what to do in those situations. So these are the symptoms of a hypo. It's worth having a look at these in your own time, just so you can spot them and know what they are. If somebody is having a hypo, make sure they just sit out for a second and have a look at what their blood sugar levels are. And we'll come on to the next steps for that. If it goes too low, so we don't want the blood sugar levels going too low, because that can cause somebody to become unconscious, they can have a fit. If they go really low, people can actually die from this. So hypos are very serious. And at the other end of the spectrum, we don't want blood sugar levels to go too high either. So it's always a difficult balancing act. If somebody has what's called a severe hypo, that is when they can't take their hypo treatment themselves. It might be that they've passed out. So this is where they would need help to treat it. And we'll mention now what that help is. But for a general hypo, so someone's noticed their blood sugar levels are 3.1, that's obviously below 4. What they will need to do is eat around 20 grams worth of fast-acting carbohydrates. So that's the sugars that can get into the body quickly. Things like chocolate, and you need something that's fast-acting sugar. So that can be things like glucose or dextrose tablets. You've got sweets, so things like jelly babies, sugary drinks, so a bottle of Lucozade, a bottle of Coke, all the full sugar ones, glucose gels, and so on. There's different choices for different people of what hypertreatment works best for them, which gets into their system quickest, and so on. Once they've taken that, you should wait 15 minutes to make sure that the blood sugar levels are rising. And then before they take part in activity, they may or may not need a snack, because obviously you don't want to go straight back down the blood sugar lowering straight away. So they may want something like a banana or a cereal bar. And then they should also just keep an eye on, or you as the person involved should keep an eye on the person who's just treated a hypo. So they should be able to do it themselves. People will know what they're doing, but it's just worth you making sure that they are checking their blood sugars regularly if they need to, and having their hypo treatment. So when we say hypo treatment or hypo kit, it's as simple as a bottle of Coke or a bottle of Lucozade or whatever sugary brand you want. All the dextrose, glucose tablets, the little gels, all these things you find in all the supermarkets that would be advertised as for gym goers as an energy boost. So there isn't any, or you shouldn't be buying any or need to buy any specialist diabetic hypo treatments or anything like that. It's just simple sugar that gets into your system quick. So I'm hoping I've explained that. So Lucozade, Coke, dextrose tablets, glucose tablets, exactly the same things that people without diabetes that want a sugar boost, a glucose boost before they go to the gym, the same kind of things that they have. If it's a severe hypo, so we're not trying to scare you, this is you know, pretty rare. For people with type 2 diabetes, it's hardly ever occurs. This is when the hypo is so severe, people can't do this stuff themselves. They can't have a fast sugary drink because they've maybe too drowsy, they've gone unconscious and so on. So here's where you put them in the recovery position and call an ambulance. If you have a glucagon pen handy, you can inject that yourself. Otherwise, that would be what the paramedics do when they turn up. The first thing that they do is will be give a glucagon injection. So that's only if someone's having a severe hypo where they've basically passed out, they've not been able to have their own hypo treatment. If somebody has had a severe hypo, they shouldn't exercise for at least 24 hours after. So if somebody comes to one of your sessions and says, this morning I had a severe hypo, whereas I had to actually go to hospital, then you would say, well, sorry, you can't join in the session this evening. We need to wait 24 hours. And that's just to make sure that the blood sugar levels have stabilized. Because as we've said, anything that's happened in the previous 24 hours can affect your blood sugar levels. So we just want to make sure people are safe. So that's just, I suppose, worst case scenario. That's not to panic you, because it's not something that happens a lot. A lot of people that I work with at Diabetes UK will tell me that they've never had a severe hypo. So, and they who may do lots of exercise. So this is only if people have not managed to have any of their fast-acting sugary drinks. So this one, I don't want to get too technical because it's not to have a kind of, I suppose, diabetes experts, but it's just so you know this, because it is a mistake I suppose I see a lot of physical activity people make, is the fact that blood sugar levels can go up and down. It's not just going down. So when I hear people in the gym always say, you know, oh, my blood sugar levels are going down because I'm exercising, that's not necessarily always the case. So if you're doing those anaerobic activities, and again, I know most of you are a physical activity professional, so I won't go into depth on all this stuff, but if you're doing those short, you know, high intensity exercises, so those powerful explosive movements, it's more likely that your blood sugar levels are going to go up because of the stress hormones that are being released. If you're also under stress, so if you're in a sports tournament and so on, your blood sugar levels are also going to raise. But again, this isn't an exact science, so it's not the same for everybody. it won't always have the same effect on you every day. As we've said before, if something else has happened in the past 24 hours, it might do the opposite. So that's why it's always very difficult. And we always recommend checking your blood sugar levels regularly, because it's not an exact science. You can't guarantee that just by jogging, your blood sugar levels will always go down. But there's an assumption that 99% of the time that will happen, but it doesn't make it definite. So if you're doing those powerful explosive movements, so things like training with weights, tight warm-ups in schools and so on, we'd expect your blood sugar levels to go up. If you're doing the more aerobic stuff, they're more likely to go down. So for most of you who work with the general public, it's more likely that blood sugar levels will go down, because it's more likely that they'll be doing activities in your gyms and so on, such as jogging and that sort of stuff. But if you're doing a lot of or just anaerobic work, so if you're just doing a weightlifting session where it's just those powerful movements non-stop, then we'd expect blood sugar levels to go up. Stretching doesn't normally have any sort of effect. It just keeps blood sugar levels at the same level. And then just to confuse even more, here's where it can change per sport, where when somebody says, if I'm playing football, will my blood sugar levels go up and down? Well, it depends, because on your position as well. Because if you're doing a lot of sprinting for the ball, that's anaerobic, so it's more likely to go up. However, if your role is more a jogger during the game and you're just doing brisk walking and dribbling, then it's more likely to go down. So this is where I see a difference through some of the type 1 friends who say when they're doing an 11-a-side football game, their blood sugar levels usually go down. But when they do 6-a-side or futsal or the much shorter games where you're sprinting a lot more and you've got a lot more of the ball, they find that their blood sugar levels go up. So it's really hard to work out what levels you're at. So here's why it's worth testing regularly. So this is just another way to show it. Again, this is more for people with type 1 or those on medication that changes blood sugar levels. Not everybody will need to worry about this as much. So you might have people with type 2 whose blood sugar levels don't change very much because they're not on that sort of medication. So this is more for people that are either type 1 or type 2s that are on medications that change the blood sugar levels. So here's just another way of showing it. So there's more techniques that people can use. So what some of the professional sports people with diabetes do is if they notice that their blood sugar levels are going too low because they've been doing aerobic work such as the jogging, they may just do a few sprints straight after, because then it will help their levels go slightly up. So it's a tricky one to manage for most people, but flexibility, stretching, yoga, that sort of stuff shouldn't have an effect on blood sugar levels. But as we've said, the activity might not, but depending on what people have done in the past 24 hours might affect whether it's going to go up or down. Here's just some numbers to show you. This is on our website and you can have this presentation, so I'm not going to talk about this now, but it's just there in case you're interested. When people are looking at their blood sugar levels and they check their monitor, here's it's a recommendation, it's not an exact science, but here's where we would say if it's less than 4, that's a hypo, which we've talked about. So people would have to have their fast-acting hypo treatment. There's no two ways around it. You have to solve it there and then. If it's between 4 and 7, that's the kind of target range you'd normally want someone with diabetes to be at before they're exercising. But because we know that blood sugar levels are more than likely to probably go down, that's why you might want a snack, just to make sure that you don't go below 4. If it's between 7 and 13, that's usually the ideal number. But again, it's all varying on what activity you're doing. You'll know yourself as the individual with diabetes, what your blood sugar levels are like during different sports. So a lot of it is trial and error. So if somebody's new to an activity, make sure they're checking their blood sugars regularly or more than often so they can see what the trends are. And again, one of the issues is we don't want blood sugar levels to be too high. In the short term, it causes dehydration, so your sports performance isn't going to be as good. But if it goes too high, that can lead to ketones, which is acid in your blood, which can lead to the complications. So when people think, well, actually, why don't we just get somebody with diabetes to have lots of carbs? And if they carb load for a marathon or something like that, won't that solve the problem of not going too low? Well, it doesn't, because people become dehydrated and it's very dangerous to have your blood sugar levels too high. So hopefully that explains. I won't go into depth on this because I've not got time, but you can look through the numbers if somebody wants to. So the main things I wanted to cover were, I suppose, some tips for coaches, clubs, people working in the physical activity industry. So it is important to encourage people to have regular contact with their diabetes health care team. Again, it's not for you as somebody in the physical activity world to be having to give all the advice, and you shouldn't be doing that. Hopefully this session is just to make you more aware of what some of the key problems are, which are making sure you look after your feet and having a hypo, so going, your blood sugar levels going too low, and what you can do about that. You need to make sure that you're encouraging participants to regularly test their blood sugar levels if it's appropriate to them. So again, they will know whether they need to or not. But especially, as I've said, a new activity, it's that trial and error of people seeing what trend and what effect it has on their blood sugar levels, because it's not the same for everybody. You should be aware of the symptoms of hyperglycemia. So the things I mentioned before, you know, blurred vision, shaking, going pale, and so on. The easiest solution for that is just get somebody to test their blood sugars. And then you know whether it's either someone's just put a lot of exertion into the exercise, or whether they are below 4. And that's where you can get people to then have their hypotreatment of the glucose tablets or the bottle of Lucozade. With that, always encourage participants to have some of their fast-acting carb hypotreatment. So you might hear it called hypotreatment, hypo kit, and so on. So make sure people are bringing that themselves. My other recommendation would be, so you've got a bit of confidence, is just have some sort of glucose or dextrose tablets or Lucozade or whatever it might be in your first aid kit. So whether that's the one at reception or if you're a coach that's out and about, very easy to do. Go to any of the high street supermarkets or beauty shops, those kind of places, or the gym places, and just buy, it's exactly the same as you would for somebody without diabetes, the little glucose gel energy drinks, anything that's fast acting, dextrose tablets, so on, sweets, and then just check the dates on them. So I would suggest getting something just small and easy for you to carry around in your first aid kit, something that has a good shelf life so you don't have to keep getting new ones all the time because it's not been used. But again, you'd want to encourage other people with diabetes, to bring their own, so you don't have to always worry about having to give this out all the time. So encourage people to have their own fast-acting hypotreatment, but carry a backup as well in your first aid kit. And again, this won't necessarily be applicable to everybody, but some people with type 2 may tell you that their blood sugars aren't too much of a problem for them because they're not on certain medications. If it's practical, have some carb snacks as well, because once you've had that hypotreatment and your blood sugars have started to rise, there's no point if it then goes back straight away below 4 and you've just got to have those fast-acting sugars again. So you want to have some sort of carb snack. So again, this would just depend on your workplace and what you're doing. So it should be the participant's responsibility, but it'd be handy if you know where those carb snacks are. So things like a banana, a cereal bar, and so on. So do you have them in your vending machines? If you work in a leisure centre or a gym, you know where they're readily available. And again, it would just depend on the activity you're doing and the level. So if it's more professional, like marathon runners, they will already have all this in place. And it's worth just remembering that everyone with diabetes is different. So that's why we can't make generalisations, because two people won't use the same hypotreatment. Some people, one compared to the other, may say that one works for them by giving fast-acting sugar. One may say it doesn't get into their system quick enough, or they seem to have problems with it. So not everybody's the same. It's not just a case of this will solve everyone's problems. That makes sense. And then just my final slide on tips for coaches is that it's worth remembering that the participants will know more than you, or should know more than you. So it's not for you to kind of memorize everything I've been talking about today, because I know I've thrown loads of info at you. I just thought that would be the easiest way, rather than try and be interactive. I'll just give you all the information and hopefully some of it will stick. But participants should know this stuff. But just in case they don't, or just to make you more confident in your sessions, carry some of that fast acting hypo treatment with you, and just make sure people are testing regularly. People may need to snack during exercise and use sugary drinks. So here's the one that, you know, always annoys me when I go into some of the physical activity places, And when I hear people say, and I've actually heard this from personal trainers and others that may know better, I can't believe you're having a can of Coke after the exercise. You're never going to lose weight that way. Or what you're doing, I can't believe you're eating jelly babies during the exercise. That's just not healthy. There's far too much sugar in that, and so on. So hopefully from today's session, you've realized why it's so important that people with diabetes may need to eat sugary products or have a high carb snack after exercise or during exercise. So hopefully that's been explained why that's the case. So hopefully you'll get away from that stigma of just associating, you know, sugar as being a terrible thing and questioning why people are using it. So the participant may need to check blood sugar levels and inject insulin. So that shouldn't be a big deal. So you should make it accessible. So think about where people can do these things. So things like a changing room, even a changing room isn't always ideal. We know there's a problem as soon as someone injects insulin. There'll be the comments of, oh, is that steroids that you're injecting? People checking blood sugar levels. They don't want to be doing it somewhere necessarily where it's not suitable. So just think about, you know, is there places that you make available for people to be able to check blood sugar levels and inject insulin? And is it easily done? So you don't want to be highlighting it in front of all the group. You don't want to be making it into a massive deal, because it isn't. People with diabetes have to check blood sugar levels all the time. They inject insulin, you know, several times a day. But it's not for you as the physical activity person to, you know, be making it into a big deal and asking, you know, some of the stigmatizing questions. But just think about which questions are important for you to need to know. So things like, you know, having to share it with the group, probably not. Here's another big one I see in the physical activity world, which obviously I'm part of, is that please, you shouldn't be giving specific diabetes dietary advice unless you have a qualification that's suitable, as in you're a diabetes dietitian. So an example would be when I've heard people say, well, you can do is have a really high protein diet. High protein, that would be great, because then you're not having as many carbs and you can get energy from protein, and protein's the savior of everything. But then if you have diabetes, a lot of people are more likely to have problems with their kidneys. So if you've got problems with your kidneys, obviously you don't want to be on a high protein diet. So unless you're qualified in diabetes as a diabetes dietitian, don't be given the specific advice on diabetes. It's also worth just mentioning, it's not just about weight loss and about living with obesity. So people that can have diabetes and either be a healthy weight, they can actually be underweight as well, because not everybody is the same. And as I said before, you don't want your sessions just to be focusing on weight loss. That's where we see our reports from people with diabetes, is that's where we see a lot of people get lose a lot of motivation, because if they've not hit their, and I suppose it's the same for people without diabetes as well, if they've not hit their target that they wanted to for weight loss, it can be a bit demoralizing. So that's why we need to really emphasize all the other benefits you get from being active. So don't just focus, because this happens in the diabetes world quite a lot, where people just focus on the weight loss, and it's not just about weight loss, it's about all the other aspects of being healthy. So with that, and I suppose it's the same for all the other sessions that you'll hear today, try not to focus on what people can't do and what their issues are, but just focus on inclusion. So what can people do? So any of you that are coaches or teachers, I'm sure have done this before, don't think, well, I've got somebody coming to my session who's got X, Y, and Z as barriers, they're not going to be able to do it. Instead, just think, well, actually, what? How do I change it? Done. They'll be able to be included in that. So I'll just very quickly finish with a few resources just to highlight what we got at Diabetes UK, because I'm conscious that this was just me throwing a load of information at you, hoping some of the main points stick. But please go to our website for more details. So we do have different pages on things like blood sugar levels, different activities like walking, swimming, etc. And you can see there's all sorts of links that you can click on that will take you to things like our Swim 22 fundraising competition that you can do. There's all sorts of guides and so on. We link that in with some of the other charities, and we have things like emotional support. We have quite a lot of exercise resources. So we have posters that you can download. We have videos, there's interactive guides. So an example of one of the posters that people can do while they're at home. This was one where you can stick on your wall after every meeting. So in between all the sessions today, here's some simple chair-based exercises you can do. And you'll see, hopefully the eagle-eyed people will see, that these aren't necessarily a diabetes-specific one. So hopefully what I covered today, there's no reason why people with diabetes can't be doing anything that you've already got at your places of work or in your lesson plans. It's just making you more aware of checking blood sugar levels, possibly needing carbohydrates, possibly needing fast-acting carbs, possibly needing to use insulin, and a few other little minor things. But in general, the same activities can be done for people with diabetes or people without. So there isn't a special, you know, this is the best exercise for diabetes. It's things that everybody can do. It's just a screenshot to show some of the videos on our webpage when you go. So the simple ones, such as a 4-minute one on moving your arms, but then we have longer ones of full body workouts. We have the link to the We Are Undefeatable videos that I'm sure will be mentioned. So it's worth checking out the webpage for that. And then finally, just to say, we do have an interactive guide that people with diabetes can use that we've had some great feedback on. So it's interactive because people can fill in different things about your questions that are asked and scores and can see their progress and so on. So that's free to download from our website. And then finally, we also have the Know Your Risk tool, which you might find handy. So this is just where you're asked 7 questions. An algorithm works out what your risk of type 2 diabetes is. So if it's low, increased, moderate or high. So the idea is we do this at different, you might have done it before and we have it at different roadshows and so on. But you can download this online if you're doing any sort of projects around diabetes. Right. So you can see that if you've got a high risk of diabetes and so on, and then we give advice on the action that you can take from that. So that was just a very quick talk from me. I'll open up for any questions once I've worked out how to stop sharing my screen.
Brilliant.
Hopefully thanks. That's come back and yeah, and just, it's one of them where apologies for not making it interactive and Q&A and joining in all the rest of it. But my thinking was, there's so much information to give. What's the quickest and easiest succinct way to do it? I'll just babble on as quick as I can for an hour and hopefully some things might stick in your mind.
Yeah, it's absolutely brilliant. And I think it's testament, first of all, that there's actually more people at the end of the webinar than there was at the start. So you've not lost anyone. And that was really, really interesting. And I mean, just on a personal level, I've got a couple of people in my life that are recently, well, one's been diagnosed and one's diagnosed pre-diabetic. So just understanding, so I'm kind of not ashamed to say I didn't know a lot of what you've just said there. So just to have that basic level understanding is going to be really useful. We have had a few questions, which I'll pop to you. I've jotted down, so I have to try and read my own handwriting. But the first was from Johnny, who's asked, he asked Hertfordshire specific. I don't know the answer Hertfordshire specific yet, Johnny, so I'm going to ask Neil generally. If you have concerns over someone that's got cuts or wounds on their feet, which when you mentioned earlier in your slides, what action should you take? Where should you suggest? Is there somewhere they should be referred, or what should happen in that situation?
Yeah, so the first thing would be obviously to speak to that person and find out what the issues are and so on, and you know how long they've had these cuts for and whatever, which I know it's one of those questions where it's, I suppose, easier said than done, because you'd hope that you could say to somebody, look, you've got some cuts here, or I'm concerned about your feet, you need to take the appropriate action. Whether they listen to you or not is another story. At least you've done your part. In terms of where to send them to, the person should have a diabetes healthcare team in place. So you suggest that they speak to someone in their diabetes healthcare team. So rather than you having to know an exact place to go, or you know, a podiatrist's number or whatever, that individual should have this within their healthcare team. It will be for their either they'll have their own podiatrist, or obviously we know that in the current climate everybody doesn't always get the same access and have these things available. So I wouldn't want to just say that yes, everything's perfect and people have all these things in place. But the easy way would be to get them to speak to the healthcare team. And that could include or would include somebody like the GP as a first port of call, who can then say, yes, I've looked at your feet and either there's not a concern, or yes, we're going to put you straight through. He'll have the, or she will have the contacts for the relevant podiatrist and so on. So yeah, I suppose the easiest way to put it for the answer is just get that person to speak to their diabetes healthcare team. And that's why I mentioned in one of the slides near the end is that people should have their diabetes healthcare team, and it's important to encourage those regular healthcare appointments, because as I said, it's not for you to become a diabetes expert or start trying to signpost everywhere, because I'm conscious you've got all these other talks as well today that, you know, you can't remember all these things of where to send people. It's just knowing that, well, actually, oh, problems with their feet, yeah, I've got to make sure they spoke, and then they can come back to their next session and say, yes, I spoke to my GP, to the healthcare professionals, and they either said, I can't continue because my foot's got that problematic that it's I can't put any weight on it, or they might say, yes, it's fine, I've plastered it up, it's bandaged up, and now I'm okay to carry on.
Absolutely brilliant, thank you very much. And another question's come from Claire, which came in as you were first introducing about someone going through an event experiencing a hypo, was that can anyone, regardless of prevalence of diabetes, have a hypo, or is that a specific event that happens at someone, that only someone if they're living with diabetes?
Just diabetes. So, well, I won't want to say never, because I'm sure there's the one in a billion person, as it is with any condition. But what happens is, if you don't have diabetes, your insulin will kick in. So I'm presuming the question might mean if somebody never had any carbohydrate or never ate anything, would they have a hypo? So if you weren't eating anything, so if you weren't eating anything, would you have a hypo? So in those kind of situations, although I don't think it would be classed as a hypo, but it would still be
similar reaction.
But normally if you don't have diabetes, your body's working out how much, even if you're not having the carbohydrate, it's working out, well, actually, I won't be releasing as much insulin because you don't need to, I don't need to lower your blood sugars because it's already low. I actually need to release more glucagon and so on. So when it comes to the technical side of it, no, you wouldn't expect any, you know, somebody in general. So yes, there might be exceptions where if somebody hasn't eaten for a week, obviously yeah, I wouldn't recommend that, because then in medical terms, they may class it as some sort of hypo. Well, they probably class it as a hypo, yes. But in general, somebody that's on a very, very low-carb diet wouldn't or shouldn't have a hypo, because the body will just not release as much insulin or produce a bit more glucagon.
Brilliant. Thank you. I think that answers that really well. And this one's not so much a question, but maybe if you have a reflection. Someone watched today actually has type 1 diabetes and says they've always been advised not to undertake any exercise under sugar levels of 10. Does that sort of ring true? Yeah, is that a tough thing to reflect on?
So what happens with that will be, that's why I said before, it's all very individual, not an exact science. So I'm hoping that the person that's asked that question, they've got that advice from their healthcare team, their diabetes experts. So that it's not just being read online by, you know, a personal trainer who's decided that should be the case. So it's all individual. So I know some people that if they're more likely to, so this could be an individual where their blood sugars do lower very quickly, and that just happens to them. So I've just seen something pop up, diabetic nurse. Yeah, so it will be, they've looked at your individual circumstance, and it might be that they've noticed that your blood sugar levels do drop quickly, very rapidly. So they've recommended 10 as a safety for you. Whereas for somebody else, say like a weightlifter, they know that their blood sugar levels are probably going to go up if a professional does weightlifting every day, and that's their bread and butter, they know from experience and trial and error that their blood sugar level will go up every day. They may start at 4 or 4.1 because they know that as soon as they start, it's going to go up. So they're not worried about hypos or having to take any carbs. So it's just per individual. So in general, that guide we said around the 7 to 11, again, there's caveats. We're presuming people are doing, you know, kind of low to moderate activity. So somebody new to your sessions that comes and says, so the typical one will be, I have type 2 diabetes, I want to be a bit more healthy, lose a bit of weight. I would presume that your session will then be, you know, brisk walks and maybe some gentle jogs, that sort of stuff. So we would presume that blood sugar levels are going to start to lower. So we know that 7 to 11 range is okay. But yeah, it's per individual. So if a diabetes nurse has looked at your history, they may decide that, yeah, 10's a better number for you, a safer number.
Fantastic. And then I think we've got time for one more. First of all, there's lots of lovely praise on the chat for people that have found this webinar really useful. So that's great. Taryn, who I know personally through the university, has written, more diabetics are using CGM, continuous glucose monitors, to check their sugar levels, but these are not always reliable and accurate during exercise, according to research. Do you have any guidance? What guidance do you have about use of CGM, if any?
Yeah, so if, again, it's one of them where if you're, so I suppose the easy way to put it is trial and error is always the best one. So if you know that your CGM isn't always accurate, so we hear that a lot, especially with exercise, because there's always a bit of a delay in how it measures and what it measures. So for that reason, you may want to, especially if it's a new activity, go back to finger pricking and seeing your levels, so you can get that instant knowledge and then keeping the diary of knowing what the trends are. So when you do this new activity, is it starting, does it rise, does it lower? When you have carbs or insulin at different times of the day, does that affect it? So here's why it's so important that you have your diabetes experts with you to go through this sort of stuff. So it's not just, and that's why I said at the beginning for everyone else on the call, it's not about you as a personal trainer or whatever your job might be, as the sports coach, then be trying to come up with some sort of diabetes plan and so on, because everyone's completely individual. So it'll be for the person who just asked the question about the CGM to link up with their diabetes team and see, well, what are our solutions. But the simplest one would be to, so you are right, the research does show, especially with exercise, it's not always accurate. So if you're worried about or you think from your own body that the CGM is wrong, so it's telling you you've either got low or high sugars, when you know from your feeling that it's not, that's not the case, then just go back to finger pricking to make sure it's accurate. But yeah, the question is right though, it's not, yeah, especially during exercise, the CGMs aren't always ideal. And for certain activities, you may need to take them off anyway.
Fantastic. Oh, thank you so much, Dale. I think if nothing else, what I've taken away is it's complicated. It's very individualised, as a lot of the work with the long-term health condition is. I think in particular, I found it your comments about the football and how you can have completely different reactions as to different types of football, if it's more sort of anaerobic or aerobic and those sorts of things, which I think makes it really relevant to our sector and the people in the room. That all that leaves me to say is a massive thank you. We'll have your resources and bits and pieces on our website, so everyone watching will be able to access those from next week. If you've got specific questions for Neil in the follow-up, you'll be able to contact through the different resources that we put on there. I think that will draw us to a close. So thank you very much again, Neil.
No, thank you for having me. And as I said, just go to the Diabetes UK website, type in exercise, and yeah, you can find out more info from us there.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.